Good afternoon. So I am assuming you have had no sessions on radio astronomy, right? So that's now. So to start that, we will just have this PDF file, which I don't know. I'm told that in Docker you cannot pop up anything. So you, but you have this file in your notebook directory. So I want to start little bit with the introduction, and I also want to thank some of these people who have helped me and David to create this, for creating the second module. So what is so different about observationally in radio astronomy? The thing is, in every single band, whether you're talking of optical, X-ray or even gamma rays, it is always you're talking of electromagnetic radiation, photons, and then you're directly receiving the light. In radio, unfortunately, that's not how we observe. We observe the voltages at different antenna, and then we phase them together, or we pass them together, and then the voltages which are in phase, you will see a signal, and which are out of phase, you will see no signal. It's like an interference pattern, and that's why it's called radio interferometry. And there is a reason for doing that, and which we will come to while we will be working on this. So radio astronomy involves lot of electronics knowledge and lot of mathematical and numerical knowledge, because when you collect the voltages, it turns out that the complex products of the two voltages from two different antenna, it is a Fourier transform of the true intensity which you were planning to, which you were originally wanting to measure from the sky. So that's why the radio imaging is called synthesis imaging. It is not like, it is a synthesized imaging. You are creating a map based on your knowledge, and that map could be right or wrong based on whether you have done a good synthesis of your data or not. And it has happened because in radio, probably the benefit of radio astronomy is, of course, you can observe during the daytime. This is a pretty good time to observe any object in the radio band. You don't have to wait for the night. So that is one benefit. But one of the drawback of radio astronomy is that all your, you know, telephone signals, mobiles, Reliance Jio, all your TV, they are all working in the radio frequencies, and they are millions of times brighter, higher. The signals are higher than the ones which you will observe or detect from the astronomical objects. So which means they tend to interfere with your data. They tend to have those unwanted signals. They create those unwanted signals, and you need to remove those signals from the radio data. And that's when you create a good image. And if you let this unwanted signals be, and you will not know beforehand, because you're not looking at the image directly from the sky. All you're getting is these voltages which you do not know from where did they come. So it is possible that these unwanted spurious signals, radio frequency interference, RFI which we call it, can go into the data and create unwanted sources in the noise. And I do remember when I was first time I was doing my project I was doing with Professor Govind Swarup, the one who made GMRT, and I was analyzing a spectral data, a spectrometry, and I was looking and I saw this signal and I started jumping. Okay, I detected the line, but it turned out to be the radio frequency interference from some mobile signal. So you have to be very careful in radio data analysis. So, but at the same time, it is very important. So for example, if you see in this image, this is actually the same spatial scale, and this is the center of a radio galaxy. And you see in the optical, you don't see anything, you know, it looks a very ordinary image. There's nothing special about it. But when you see the same thing in the radio band, you will see that this looks a very, very different image. Okay, I didn't have the space to have this full image, but there is actually absolutely nothing in these positions and those sided this side. So this is coming only in the radio emission, and it is called, it is non-thermal emission, which means you cannot, this emission cannot be, you know, you cannot identify it with one temperature. It is non-thermal because it doesn't follow E is equal to h nu kind of thing. In thermal emission, as you increase the frequency, your energy or your emission will increase, but that doesn't happen in radio. And this is coming from something called synchrotron, and synchrotron is a very exotic phenomena. It is a relativistic version of cyclotron, and you basically accelerate the electrons to relativistic energies, and then in the presence of magnetic field they will do the relativistic cyclotron or synchrotron. But the amazing thing is that to have this emission in the radio band, which is, for example, this image is in 1420 megahertz or 20 centimeter, the electron which had a rest mass of 0.5 MeV, it has to reach to GeV kind of energies. It has to get accelerated to that energy. Okay, so you can imagine how much acceleration you need to provide to the electron, and that should tell you the exoticness of this process, that in astronomy, in the sky, and there are places where such exotic accelerations are taking place, where they are able to move these electrons from this rest mass to 511 kilo electron volt to GeV kind of energies, and you are able to see this kind of emission. So that's why the radio, and these things do not happen anywhere in the sky. These things require very exotic locations, the locations which are working in extremes of astrophysics, extreme velocities, extreme high amount of magnetic field, or location of explosions, and or, you know, surrounding the black hole or magnetars. So these are very exotic objects. So that's why when you see the radio emission, a non-thermal synchrotron radio emission, you know that these are the sites of particle acceleration, and these are extremely difficult to do it in our labs, and you are able to do that. So you actually study these phenomena, and this gives you a huge amount of information, and which we will come to in the second module little bit. And also you have some, for example, there are some new phenomena of fast radio bursts which we still don't know, but they have been seen only in the radio bands, and we don't know them in any other band. We don't know what they are. So there are these exotic phenomena, there are these coherent emission. Coherent emission is the emission, you may have read that, when the population inversion happens, and then they all, you know, this come down and photons are emitted in phase, and this sudden burst of photons. And there are some magnetic stars where, even though there are a handful of them, these coherent emission have been seen, and this coherent emission can increase this flux or the radiation by factor of few tens or to up to 100. So these things are seen, and pulsar has coherent emission. So these things are seen in the radio band. So these radio band is pretty exotic. And second thing is that our universe is dominated by hydrogen, as all of us know, and radio is the best way to know that, because this, you see this galaxy, I think this is NGC 6946. This is, you see, in the optical band, and the same scale you see in the radio band. Now in optical band, what do you see? You mainly see the starlight, right? Star formation. So you know that wherever it is brighter, there more stars are being formed, and O kind of stars, B stars, and heavier stars. But if you see here, this is, you would think that galaxy is only this big, but actually not true. You see, the galaxy is much more bigger. Why? And you are seeing this is all neutral hydrogen. And how is neutral hydrogen producing? It is doing something called electron flip transition, okay, and this is a quantum transition. It is a prohibited transition with a probability of 10 to the power minus 15. But since there is so much of hydrogen in the universe, you do see enough of this, okay. you do see enough of this, and then that's how you get to know so about, you know, so much of neutral hydrogen. You get to you get to know so much about galaxies, the true extent of the galaxy. And this is one of the one of the key ways to find the distance of a galaxy. Why? Because this transition happens at a given frequency. That frequency is very precise. Okay, suppose you observe this transition rather than at say 1420 megahertz, but at 300 megahertz. You know if it is the H1 transition and you are seeing it at this, it means you are seeing a redshifted transition. And from that information, you can know, you will get, you can estimate how far away this galaxy must have been. And this is one of a very, in radio astronomy, one of the very crucial ways to estimate the redshift of galaxies or even the environment of galaxies, whether the galaxy was surrounded by a lot of H1 clouds or not, you know, those kind of information. So these are some of the things which you will get to know in radio astronomy. So I think it makes sense that we do try to understand them. And so I would like to come to a little bit of basics of radio astronomy, and then we will do this these exercises. Okay, so why basically we need to go to the radio interferometry? Because the resolution element of a telescope is lambda over d. Lambda is the wavelength and d is the size of the mirror. Now lambda or wavelength is much smaller for optical telescopes, right? So you can, you may make say 1 meter mirror or even much smaller, say 20 inches mirror, 14 inches mirror, and you still have a reasonable resolution. But if you have radio wavelength, suppose you have 20 centimeter wavelength, to have the same resolution as an optical, you need a 45 kilometer mirror. That's not possible to make, right? It's not feasible to make, let's say that. Okay, but this resolution is very important. Why is this resolution very important? Because otherwise you are interested in this chalk, not in this chalk. But if you do not have the resolution which can resolve this distance, this will look like one chalk. And then if you want to know the flux, you are invariably counting the radiation from this also, and you think that this is the radiation, but that's not true. And this is very important in, you know, for example, all these transient events and supernovae, gamma ray bursts, gravitational wave event, because they are most likely they are happening in some galaxies, and galaxy most likely are emitting radio bands. And if your galaxy is mixed up with your source of interest, then you have a problem. Your physics goes wrong because you think this much is radiation is coming from your object of interest, but that's not true. So the resolution is a key element, and we do not get in radio telescopes. So what do we do? Rather than making one big mirror, we make many small mirrors. Okay, so it's like, you know, you can imagine, if you have, you been to those the shops, like those repair the watch, they have these very small mirrors, right? So if you have only one single point, you can see with as small mirror as possible, it doesn't matter. But suppose you have this small mirror, and you have to see me through that mirror, you need many such small mirrors. And wherever there are no mirrors, you lose information about me. Suppose you have one small mirror which you can see this part of me, one small mirror which you can see this part of me, you don't know what is in between. So that's the thing. Radio astronomy is done, rather than with one big dish, you have multiple small dishes. Like this is a telescope, very large array in New Mexico. They have 27 dishes. Okay, they see the mirror, they have this mirror, rather than having one big 45 kilometer mirror, you have one big, say in this case this is 35 kilometer in this best scenario. So 35 kilometer mirror with holes, mirror with holes is the way we are doing, and we are trying to maximize it. Okay, so what do we do? We do something called aperture synthesis. What is this aperture synthesis? You have these mirrors at some location on the earth, and now you know that the rotation period of earth is 24 hours. So the projection of these, suppose you are observing this bulb with these three mirrors, and because earth is rotating, this projection will change with time. Okay, if your source does not change its radiation in that time, say within 3 hours, this projection is changing. If the source does not change in those 3 hours, then you can collect the data for those 3 hours, and then you have, now you still have the mirror with holes, but the holes are less, because if you see it again, you started with only just this array of mirror, Y array, but after say few hours, you have effectively these many mirrors, right? So this is the basic concept of radio astronomy. These lines they track, these are called UV tracks. Okay, so basically the whole of radio astronomy is trying to see the UV tracks, working with the UV tracks and converting into image plane. Okay, and that's what we are going to do in this class. Did you understand this, or is there any doubt, whatever, because the aperture synthesis? Okay, so you know that why we need many small mirrors, because we cannot build too many big mirrors. Now in an ideal world, you may need to build, say suppose these are 100 mirrors, you may need to build 100 mirrors to be able to see a source properly. Okay, now if that source is just, you know, if you are looking at like just this tiny dot, then it doesn't matter if it's a point source. But if it this and your mirror is this small, then you may need many mirrors, right? And you want to have as many mirrors as possible, so you may make say 100 mirrors or 200 mirrors to get the best image, but that is very expensive and it will take, you know, forever to build so many mirrors, many years. So what we do, we assume, because it is all mostly true, because these sources do not change that fast, that within few hours the sources are not changing their flux or their intensity, and then this will be clearer little in 5 minutes from now when you will do the exercise. But the concept is, suppose there are these three mirrors and these three mirrors are looking at some angle. Now because of Earth's rotation, these mirrors have moved here. Now they are looking here at this position, now they have moved here. So you are seeing the different projection, or in some sense what you can see that when the mirror was here, you were seeing this side of me. Now when you are seeing this side of me, this side of me, this side of me. So rather than having the mirrors all over me, you are having this just one set of mirror and you are rotating it and seeing the whole of me in 2 dimension, not the 3 dimension, that you cannot know, but the 2 dimension. You understand, that is the concept of aperture synthesis. But you are assuming that when you are moving the mirror from here to here, I am not moving, I am just standing still and waiting for you to see me while the mirror is moving. Okay, so that is the concept, and I am that source and I am not changing my flux. However, there are some sources, for example fast radio bursts and the sources which emit coherent emission masers, they are there for a spike of time, like, you know, maybe 2 minutes or 1 minute. In that case, this assumption is incorrect. But then you don't need too many mirrors to see those things, those kind of changes. Why? Because these kind of sudden changes will happen mostly from the point sources. Okay, at least point sources for our kind of distances. Because if they were extended sources, because any change you have to see, you have to at least no change can travel faster than the speed of light, right? So if you have to see change in a very small duration of time, then it has to be most likely a point source, it cannot be an extended source. So then the information is still not lost. But so that is the concept of aperture synthesis. Okay, clear? Anything else? Because this is a totally new concept, radio astronomy, I want you to be very comfortable with what I'm talking about, and that's why I will talk very slow, and we'll want to have, like, you know, answer as many questions as, yeah. Yeah, I am saying this is the final result. I didn't start with this. I started with this, these, but then at every time it was moving, it was also collecting the voltage or data. Okay, finally I integrated all that data and created one map. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah, effective projection, that's what I said. Here when I'm giving the analogy, there is, you know, I'm just very nearby distance, but when you're talking of astronomical objects, the source is on the earth based on its latitude and longitude, is creating a projection. Okay, let me just show you this image and it will be clear to you, but just give me a minute. But anyway, the thing is, what I wanted to tell you is that you collect the voltages from two antennas, and product of these two voltages is called visibility, and visibility is the Fourier transform of the intensity, and intensity is the quantity you are interested in. Okay, and it doesn't become, it's not so easy. This is the basic concept, and then of course you have to have in the workable unit, so you have this UVW coordinates, and then you have this LM and N image coordinates, which I will tell you in a while. Yeah.
Why isn't time in this equation?
Because this visibility in an ideal, so you have to integrate it over the throughout the observation. There is time, but here this visibility I have not, this is, I'm just showing the visibility at an instant. Okay, but when you are doing it, when you are it's just the first basic equation which you did, which you get with some celestial assumption that you have vacuum and then you have these voltages and how the Fourier transform will be. But this is not the visibility of the, you actually have millions of such visibilities at an instant of time, which again is not possible. So you have to have certain time, say 5 seconds, 2 seconds, over which you will collect the voltage, and then you will define a visibility. And a general rule of thumb is that this instant of time should be of the order of, or it should be less than 2 times the diameter of one antenna in meters divided by the overall distance, like of the your total baseline. For example, for VLA, it will be 2 into 25 because 25 meter is the diameter of one antenna divided by 35. Which is the maximum baseline or maximum size of mirror you can get. So roughly, you know, it's 1.5 to 2 seconds or so. So because that's how it works. This also assumes the instant band, like the band at 20 centimeter. But in principle, your band is 20 centimeter plus minus, say, 1 centimeter or something. But this is the ideal equation. This is not a workable equation. Okay. And then finally, and in... not just that, this assumes that you are in the continuous space, but it is actually a discrete space. You have a sampling function, you have an antenna pattern which comes into picture, and you have to deconvolve with all these effects, and then finally you get the, so it's a lot more complex. I was just trying to explain the basic concept of how you do it. Yeah. That's exactly the case, and this is what in this tutorial I will show you at the end. I have some simulated images, and I will show you that how, as you have more and more blind spots, how your images keep on getting distorted and what it looks like. Oh, blind spots, you mean that some part of this, no, when you look at the transient, you point your telescope in that direction, and then when you point in that direction and this guy is a point source, then you do not have blind spot for that guy. You have blind spot for the things if a source is extended, suppose the source is, say, that galaxy which I showed you, okay, several arc minutes, and based on which antenna, how much, if there is a hole in the mirror, how much is there? Suppose at the center, you always have little hole. Another thing is, if you go to the Fourier transform, if you remember your Fourier transform, if it is very narrow in the time, then it will be very broad in the frequency and vice versa, which means the, if there is a hole in the mirror at the center, it means the extended features will be missed out. You will not see them quite well. Okay, so that's what I am saying, the blind spot. But for these point sources, you don't have to worry about blind sources. In principle, you know, one small antenna is good enough to do it if there are no confusion. Yeah. Why are we talking of blocking a mirror? I don't.
No, I'm just trying to understand.
Okay. Mirrors do get blocked sometimes because of projection, the shadowing, it is called, if the two mirrors are very close and the source is like very close to the horizon, then you have this partial blocking of the mirror. You're not okay in, yes, all right, yeah. It's okay to have, see, the, it depends upon, you are saying aperture is smaller. You will compromise on the resolution. You will, and that's the main thing, you will compromise on the resolution, okay. And collecting area is per antenna. Yeah. That's exactly, and that's why there is something called VLBI or VLBA, very large baseline interferometry. That happens. Suppose you have 30 antennas, two of the antennas are not working, you will still observe it. The only thing which will get changed is that, see, suppose you were collecting the voltages and how many such voltages you will collect out of 30 antennas, this is 13 into 29 over 2, right? So which is 435. Now if you have 28 antennas, then it is 28 into 27 over 2, so which is much less base, little less baselines. So that's where you will compromise little bit in the sensitivity, but that won't change, you will still get the data. The number of visibilities will change, so total, you know, so your, so and that depends, your intensity depends upon that. So then your, what should I say, your intensity will remain the same, but the noise in the data will increase slightly. Yeah. So these are how the UV tracks look. These are actually UV tracks at different declination. So declination means where the source is in the sky, whether it is here, 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 or here, or here. So these are the UV tracks. Okay, it's basically a coordinate system in terms of wavelengths. So basically, if you are working at say 20 centimeter, then you will be, you know, U into, like basically this is the distance, you know, you just take the distance in three antennas. This is W, which in an ideal world we will assume to be 0, because we will assume the earth's surface is kind of, you know, flat where my antennas are for all practical purposes. And then there are two, any, we can take any coordinate system and define U and B, U and V, and in general for say VLA or GMRT, we just take the central antenna as the central zero of the coordinate system and define U and V, and then we take the W. Now, so this is B, okay, this is called baseline. So when I am saying the GMRT has 435 baseline, that simply means that with 30 antennas, you can have 435 such projections, okay, with 30 antennas. So that's what is the baseline. and the this is in the UV coordinate system. It means the data, the visibility data which you are collecting, in UVW coordinate system. Now you have to create the image. An image is called L, M and N coordinate system. Now N is generally assumed to be 0 because N is basically corresponding to a 3D structure, but you can generally see the 2D. L and M are the projection of them. Suppose your image is at S. Actually, I don't have that picture, but I have it in, I should. So this is, suppose this is my source, and in this coordinate system, this will be L, M and the W projection, okay, which is square root of 1 minus L square over M square. So in the UV coordinate, UVW coordinate system, W will be usually 0, but actually for GMRT this is not true because the GMRT is on in fields and there are next to river and canals. So even W, so you have to take care of those things and then you have to convert into L, M and N, and that's why I was telling you that so this is finally you have to take the Fourier transform and you have to get, you are given your observations get you this and you get this, and in between comes many other things which include antenna pattern and sampling function, okay, because your sampling is not continuous, so that's why it is called discrete Fourier transform, it's not a continuous Fourier transform. Okay, so now I think I will, so now there is this module where I have done it for the GMRT, and here you or why don't you try to read and run this module and see what kind of UV tracks you get. Okay, yeah.
So in aperture synthesis, does the origin of your UV coordinate system move as the Earth rotates, or is it always fixed to some?
The origin you will keep it fixed, but everything with respect to that origin has to keep shifting continuously, okay, because, and which includes every single thing in the observation. For example, even the source, suppose the you are collecting the voltages and you are assuming that the even the path length is changing from that source to the two antennas, and for every antenna, for every moment later than the previous moment or whatever you want to call it. So you fix your UV coordinate system, you fix the center of the UV coordinate system and change everything, which include delay correction, fringing and everything you can imagine basically.
Do the positions of the antennas change in the UV coordinate system?
No, they don't change. They will change only in the in the image coordinate system, not in the UV. Yeah. So do you what do you see in the UV tracks, and what do you what is the conclusion, what do you understand from that? I am just showing you for comparison that how the UV tracks will change. So suppose I want to see for 1 hour and 10 hours. I am assuming the source is up in the sky for 10 hours. You can select any wavelength. Suppose I am selecting say 20 centimeters, so this is 0.2. Okay, now you can have an array type and your UV, I just want to show you and see that UV tracks will change with whether your array is east west or north south or somewhere in between. So suppose I take the east west array. So see, in 1 hour you could track only this much, but in 10 hours you could track much more. Okay, so which means you have this projection covering all this whole thing, and now you have, imagine you have 30 such antennas at different U and V and W. Well, W is 0, but U and V, then how much more you will cover. Okay, so that's the point of this exercise. And so basically with, I am just creating with one set of antennas, one pair of antennas, and I have put those antennas east, west or north, south or somewhere in between, and I'm trying to determine the UV track with one. Okay, now with GMRT, or this is for this one is for VLA, you have in different, you know, every direction you have many set of antennas, and each track will contribute to your overall UV coverage, okay, or your visibility data. Okay, so that's the point. And here, suppose if I run again, I run say 1 or 10 again, but this time I select say, you know, again I do 20 centimeter, but this time I select north and south. You know, the track is different. You saw the track has changed. Earlier the track was looking like this. Okay, now the track is different. Okay, so this is how you, in fact, if you have time, you go back and you should see how to actually estimate the UV track based on the position of the antennas. And you can just take any latitude, you can take an equatorial position or something, it will be fun to do such kind of exercise. Okay. Okay. So now that, sorry? It's, yeah, yes. You, and then you can see the circle, the extent of circle, because it will do one full track in 24 hours. But source will not be up for full 24 hours, right? Because it has to be, suppose I take say 17, 18 degrees from the horizon, then the source will be up only for this many hours, right? So that's how it is. Okay. So now, before the second exercise, I want to show you this image. So this I have simulated this image, okay, and the contrast is not too good here, but the way I have simulated this image is for some learning purposes too. I want to show you the properties of Fourier transform, how they will change the whole thing and how UV tracks will change, okay. So what I have done, I have put one point source at the face center in this, and other thing which you cannot see is that I have also put a 2 arc minute Gaussian around this, okay. Now this 2 arc minute Gaussian is a extended source, and the point source is, well, it's a point source. Now if you remember your Fourier transform, I believe you did it yesterday, the Fourier transform of a spike, what will it be? Fourier transform will look like a straight line, right? So this part is contributed because of this, okay, and this, the extension of this, the wider it was, this should have been much more steeper, the narrower it will be. So this 2 arc second structure here corresponds to this part, okay, and this I have simulated for full, I have simulated for minus 5 hour angle to plus 5 hour angle to have the symmetric, and I had the liberty to do whatever I wanted, and I have taken all 30 GMRT antennas, and I have actually simulated it at 90 centimeter or 325 megahertz, okay. Unfortunately, I have no way to simulate such a source in Python. So there is a software called Apes, and I have simulated it in Apes. So that's why I had to put the image and its UV, visibilities look, because I do not know if I can do it in Python. But if any of you can think that I can simulate a source in Python, please let me know, because then it could be a very interesting exercise. I did try to find, but I couldn't find a way to do it. So I did it in Apes. You can do it in CASA also, which is Python based, but then you still have to install CASA, which I was told is a pretty, it's not an easy process to do, right? Installing CASA was not easy, so I just have the image. And I also put in some noise by hand. If it was not noise, then you would not have seen this kind of spread. No? So I have also put in some noise by hand in this image. So this is pretty close to a realistic image. Okay. And now this is what I want you to do it, but I'm just showing you the and you will do it in a while. So now in the same simulation, if I do it only for 1 hour, you see the UV tracks are very small. For 2 hours, little more, 5 hours, 10 hours gives you the best of the data. Okay. So that's the thing, and now this is the interesting thing. Well, again, actually the problem is that the contrast is not good, but I hope you can see that here the point source is fine, but you have lot of haziness in the 2 arc minute Gaussian. Okay, you will see, you will yourself play with these images. It's just that I wanted to show you first, but I have these images for you to play with. This is 2 hours. Well, you know, I think you can see it better on your screen, that that image is the worst and this image is the best. Is there any other difference you can see? Sorry? Do you see the point source and see something special? It's very elliptical here and it's quite pointy here. That's because of the UV projection. Okay, when you are only for 1 hour, you are just moving very little in the UV track, so it is a very elliptical kind of resolution. But if you are able to go to the, say this is much better than this already for 5 hours, and then here you have the much more circular. Okay, but that is because, okay, I forgot what declination I did it. I think I did it for some 20 declination or something, I forgot. But if you have, say, source at minus 40 declination for a location longitudinal latitude of GMRT, I have done it for GMRT, which is in the northern hemisphere. If you have a minus 50 declination, one thing is it will be up above the horizon for maybe some 2-3 hours, and also it will be very elliptical because that projection will never make that circle. Okay, so you will always have an elliptical beam, you will never have a circular beam for a very southern. So the declination decides what kind of beam shape you will have. So if your galaxy is circular, the whole galaxy will be the, basically the aspect ratio will change. So that's the only difference in the point source. Okay, but the flux, if this flux is different than this flux, then there is some problem. Then your image is not good. The flux should stay constant. Is that clear? Okay. So now let's do this ourselves. And so this is the UV dot fits. You may have it in your same directory. You will have this file. So there are some files which are called 1 hour dot fits, 2 hour dot fits, 5 hour dot fits, and 10 hours dot fits. Those are the image files. Those are the images of the data. This is a UV data. Basically, this data has all the visibilities from minus 5 hours to 10 hours. Okay, and you have to. So basically, you have to plot. You have to plot the same UV tracks. So 1 hour. 2 hour, 5 hour, and 10 hours. So you have to complete the code. I have just shown you that you from this file you just read the U and V part of the data in the fits file, and now please complete. If you see if you can complete the code and show me the visibility tracks for 5% data, 10% data, 20% data, and 100% data, and it should look like. These, the results are kind of already there, these things. So can you do that? Can you complete the thing? No, maybe I'll give you 4-5 minutes, see if you can do that. Yes, visibility is the individual component. Okay, that's an individual at a given instant between the two antennas, and these visibilities will have information about the distance between the two antennas. Why? Because it is all interference pattern. If the visibilities come in phase, okay, and in fact for an extended source the visibilities will be having maximum amplitude. It is a real and imaginary part, maximum amplitude for very close by antennas, just because the property of the Fourier transform, extended the source is narrower, the Fourier transform will look like, okay, for a Gaussian. Okay, but if you go to the very high, say UV distance or very long baseline, say 25 kilometer, you will have a very small amplitude of that visibility just by the property of this Fourier transform. In your free time later, you can also try to, you can just read the header of this file and see what all, you know, what all headers are there, and then you can do other things also at home. So now, yes. No, 10 hour was, I did it up to 10 hour because from my source it was up in the sky for almost 10 hours only. So this is the maximum, yeah, you can't get better image than this for GMRT antenna. Okay, but somewhere else in the, on the earth you may be able to get better image if, because source may be up for say 12 hours at more favorable position, you know. Fraction is, suppose I am giving 10%, so suppose it observe for 10 hours, so 10% of the time, so all the visibilities of the first 10% of the data, you know, so which means the every antenna is collected for say 10 hours, so the every visibility for first 10%, you know, so basically 10% is first 1 hour, okay. Try to write that program. I have not written, but you can certainly try because you have the full data, you can try, and it's not very difficult. Okay, yeah, okay. Now after doing this, now that you understand this basic concept, this software, it is an online software, and it's a pretty amazing software which will give you all the concepts of radio astronomy in one go, you know. So here, and this is freely available on net, okay, here you will see these are all ALMA, SCAP, ATCA, MWA, GMRT, MEERKAT, SMA, VLA, PDB, WSRT. These are all millimeter, centimeter and meter wavelength telescopes on earth, okay. And what this software does, it, you can select either one telescope system, or sometimes you may actually, it's to prepare your real proposal. Sometimes you may want to say do an observation with say ALMA plus VLA because you feel that your source and your science will be much better with that kind of a. So it actually tells you, this software, you can simulate your source and see how the galaxy or how the source, point source, whatever you are planning to observe will look, okay. So can you run this software and create in the model image? Here maybe you can take, say, you know, maybe I'll say you can take VLA and ALMA and choose some hour angle. Let's select VLA for, you know, so this is how the VLA track looks, okay. And VLA, A is the A configuration, B configuration, C and D. A is the maximum resolution configuration, which is 35 kilometer, and D is the minimum resolution, which is 1 kilometer. So we are just selecting, you know, VLA A configuration, and then you can add on the right hand side, you can select some more antennas, but I am just going to first show you one example. And then maybe I can choose a spiral galaxy, and maybe I'll just do it for, you know, much less time, and I will remove the larger time one, and then I will do the observation. So you see, we started with that image and we got something like this. We have this extra muck here, there is not all the features are collected because I did only for 2 hour observation. Because this was such an extended source, 2 hour observation did not, you know, give us a good result, right. Now I want you to try to do it with VLA D configuration, okay. And since, and you will see that you will see a better image. And let me see if you can get it and, you know, take few minutes and try to do that. Yeah, you will get, you will miss many of the features. So this you did with VLA D configuration, but did the image improve than A? It didn't improve. Okay. Okay, now you try the same thing for 8 hours. Yes. So basically minus 4 and plus 4 hour angle. And you can add some more telescope. Maybe you can add ALMA also in that. Let's see what you get. And then once you, so this, because I didn't explain this fast Fourier transform and synthesized beam and all these things. I am not explaining this, but basically synthesized beam is nothing but the Fourier transform of your sampling function, because your sampling is discrete, not continuous, not infinite. So when you get the image, you get the Fourier transform of convolution of your sampling function and your true intensity. So you have to deconvolve this thing. And once you deconvolve that with synthesized beam, then this is the final image you will get. But these things are little complex, so I am not getting too much. The whole idea is that we want to recreate that, and with this interferometry, we can do it to a good extent, but not to 100%. And after, once you have chosen a spiral galaxy, I also want you to do with the point source, and you will see that things are not that bad. And that is what enables us to do the transient science, where we have to observe very frequently, but even short exposures are fine. But if you are not able to run now with all these tricks, I would say I have given the link in the notebook. Just go and install it. It doesn't take much space, and it's easy to install on Windows, Mac and Linux, and just install and play with it and try to do with different telescopes and see how your image, the same image, change the hour angle, and try to combine the two telescopes, and you will see how your radio image is a function of the telescope and observing strategy basically. And that is why the radio imaging is called synthesis imaging. Sorry? Sampling cadence. This is like how dense your sampling function is, you know, and more denser it is, much more expensive, extensive the Fourier transform becomes. So it is that density here. Yeah. I don't know what they have put in this, but you can actually, for a telescope, you can choose your sampling function, and that would also depend upon how much integration time, whether you want 2 second, 4 second, 16 second, you know, all these things. So you can choose all these things. And good resolution. Resolution comes only because in VLA-A, the antennas are much further apart, so you have the maximum baseline of 35 kilometer, whereas in VLA-D, you have maximum baseline of 1 kilometer. Because VLA antennas are on a train track, and they move, they can change their distance, so, and B and C are in between configurations. Okay, so B is 10 kilometers, C is I think 5 kilometer, and D is 1 kilometer. No, the wavelengths are same. That's why the same wavelength, same object at a same wavelength, you will have a different resolution at different configurations. Because suppose your source is faint and extended source, okay. Now you have many more resolution elements, your flux is spread into many more pixels, and it may be below your detection limit. So if something is very faint and extended, you will be better resolving them at D configuration. But something, suppose I have a galaxy which is only 2 arc seconds away, then I will observe at VLA say 5 gigahertz in a configuration so that that galaxy does not interfere with my image, right? Something like that. Okay, I think since only 10 minutes are left, I think let's move on to the next thing. Yeah? Okay. And let's close this because this software is online, okay? I have not written it. So that's the good thing, you can do it at home also. Now you can actually see the real images, okay? So I have actually, since I said I could not find a way to create these images for you to create these images in Python, I have created and put it, but you can actually run this. You can choose 1 hour, 2 hour, 5 hour and 10 hour, and then you can play this image and you can actually check the intensity, how it is changing with time. So this is for example, this is my image. I can zoom into this part. Okay, you see the Gaussian and the point source coming up much better. You can put your, you see here, you can, these are the pixels. This is the intensity which I can't show you, but you will be able to see in your thing, you know, and this keeps changing. So you can zoom in, you can play with this image, you can look at the images, you can see the 10 hour image, you can see the 1 hour image, and you can see, again, it's difficult to see here because the contrast is not good, but on your laptop you will see that when you zoom in, you will see the features are much more distorted in 1 hour and much less distorted in 10 hour image. So why don't you do this exercise, and then I have a next exercise for you to do in the class, but let's just look at the images, different images, and play with these images. Here you can also see the scale is in flux, and you can see the maximum flux of the pixel from this scaling, minimum flux. So this is all noise, maximum flux is around 0.1 Jansky, okay. You can see it in different images. If you are able to do this, I want you to complete the code in the next cell in which you have to find the flux density. You have to find the flux density of the point source of a noise and somewhere close to the source. So what you have to do is, you create a box and then you will see these pixel sizes, and then you have to count the number of pixels in a box. And then divided by the how many pixels one beam is coming, and that I have already written for GMRT, it is 19. So can you complete the code and find the flux of at least one source right now? In this one, in the image statistics, basically you want to create the image statistics for different positions in the sources. One, confining the noise to see how much noise I have put in the field, and one of the point source. Here, just to explain to you, when I select the box, then this is the bottom XY and this is the top XY. So x2, y2, x1, y1, when you select these, then you have to count the number of pixels in these and flux in each pixel, which you know in the image, you have the FITS file, and simply divide by the beam size, which in our image is 19, okay. So that number I am giving you. So just complete the course to extract the flux of each pixel from your box. Could anyone manage to write the, complete the code and find the flux in some pixels in a box? You? Okay. So which area did you choose? Did you choose the phase center or some noise area? Where the source is. How much flux did you get? 3.28 millijansky. That sounds little less. The flux I had put in was, I think, few tens of millijansky. Basically, you have to write the code to find the number of pixels and flux in each pixel, sum them up and divide it by the beam size, which I am telling you is the 19 pixel. You did that? You are getting 3 millijansky for a source. No, something seems off. That should not change. No, I think I did estimate. I got 226 millijansky for the source. So you are getting roughly one tenth of that, huh? Something. Did anybody else manage to get that flux? 352. Okay, that sounds much better, because see, the thing is, I have a point source and this Gaussian, and depends upon how big a box you choose, you may get different flux, because this Gaussian is also around 1 Jansky Gaussian. So 326, 3 something sounds better. 3.46 is something is off. 296 sounds also okay. Yeah. And now you should do the same exercise for a different image. You pick a box around this Gaussian, this extended source. So this is the point source, this is the Gaussian. Now the exercise is, you pick the box around this and take the 1 hour image and 10 hour image, and you will see that in 1 hour image this flux is much lower than the 10 hour image. And that is what called missing flux. And in extended source, you run into this missing flux problem. Okay, so try this exercise. And I think, since there's not much time, it's 3:05 already. If you have any, you can do it at home also. And if you, in the meantime, if you have any quick question, you can ask before we take a break and start the next module. Bigger box. So then it is okay. Then it's okay. Anyway, just try to do that and see. The physics behind, the idea behind it is to do it for one hour and 10 hour and see the flux difference and how you run into missing flux problem. That will be the noise. That will be much less. Near the point. So where the Gaussian is there. Now Gaussian is only within 2 arc minute. Yeah. So that's the. You can see, right? That also. That's what the whole thing is. You can. So suppose I can take, say, this box, right? This box, because this includes the Gaussian. You can't see, in contrast is not good here, but this includes much of the Gaussian. And this box, you see the 535.988. Those things are there, right? You can. So this is the box, you know, this is the x1, you know, bottom x pixel, bottom y pixel and top x and y pixel. You can choose these and then you can find the flux, and you will see the flux for 1 hour integration and the 10 hour is very different. Okay, so that's the exercise. And I think this part we can probably end here.